done it again, Lord. You've done it again. You are good and you are mighty and you are merciful. And you keep taking care of me when I don't deserve it. Praise you, Jesus. You are Lord. Give me another one, Lord. Guide me to who you want me to help. Raise up more that will call upon your name. Raise up those that love you and seek you and trust you. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up. Lord, we need a generation of believers who are not ashamed of the gospel. We need an army of believers, Lord, that hate to be lukewarm and will stand on your word above all else. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up. I pray for unity among those that love you. I pray that you open their eyes so that they can see your truth, Lord. I pray for your hand of protection and guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will take light into this world, that will not compromise when under pressure, that will not cower, Lord, when others fall away. Raise them up, Lord, that they will proclaim that there is salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. Raise up warriors, Lord, who will fight on their knees, who will worship you with their whole hearts, Lord. Lord, call us to battle, that we may proclaim King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I pray these things with all my heart. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up.
Come on, let's all stand. Hallelujah. Lift your hands, where are you at? Hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah. Sing unto the Lord, hallelujah. Sing it unto the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Father God, we come before you in the name of Jesus. Thank you for being here in this place. Lord, I pray that you'll remove me. Let the Spirit of God flow through me this morning. Speak, Father God, to your people as you've spoken to me. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray and we say amen and amen. Come on, let's give it up for Jesus this morning. Praise God. Thank you, worship team. Right there where you're at, open your Bibles. Remain standing. It's all right. Two more minutes. Remain standing. We're going to read the word right here in Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 1. Will you have it? Say amen. Praise the Lord. like somebody says, they're going to be standing longer. So hopefully not that long, but long. Amen. Hallelujah. Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 1. When you have it, say amen. The Bible reads and it says, while Jeremiah was still confined, everybody say confined, in the courtyards of the guards, the word of the Lord came to him a second time. And this is what the Lord says, he who made the earth and the Lord who formed it and established it, the Lord is his name. 3, verse 3 says, call to me and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. And we'll stop there. And you can be seated, amen. Praise God. I just want to welcome everybody that are watching through Facebook Live. Amen. I see my brothers watching from Virginia. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And we got some people. So you got to tag family. Hallelujah. Tag, share, tag, and share. Amen. But we're going to finish up this morning. Amen. On a Super Bowl Sunday. Amen. We're going to finish our theme of prayer. And we'll be talking about prayer that works. Amen. And we've been hitting it and hitting it and hitting it and being specific in our prayer. Hopefully you have caught something within our themes, amen. And hopefully one of the things that you have caught or opened your mind to is about prayer, that we can't live without prayer, amen. And prayer moves the hands of God. So this morning, amen, we're going to talk about, amen, the war room. That's the title, amen, of the message, amen. War room, prayer is a powerful weapon, amen. And I don't know about you, but I know that I have some young teenagers in my house, and they like to play that game Warzone, right? I just watch it real quick and stuff, but I don't even know what's going on. But I know that one of the things, or I know one of the things is prevent to get killed, but that happens, amen? And the second thing is to get you better weapons to be able to go further, right? And that's what Christianity needs. We need better weapons. And God gives us those weapons in our hands to be used as tools. So therefore, because I don't know about you, but hopefully you understand today, but I know this, that we are in a war, right? We're not saying in a war there in Iraq or there, you know, we're fighting and all that stuff. We're actually in a war spiritually. Amen. Spiritually, we're in a war. And when we begin, I don't know if you've seen this movie before, and sometimes this movie is probably related, we can relate it to a couple and all that stuff, but in reality, the point of the whole story is prayer works. A lot of us, well, I've seen it. I don't have no issue with my marriage yet. It's coming. Don't worry about it. Amen. Because if you have a perfect marriage, I want to see you after church and give me the recipe. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. But therefore, amen, and we can relate it to that. But in reality, amen, the whole message behind the movie and Inspire is for men and women to catch what? Catch a behavior or an attitude of prayer within our lives. Can I get an amen? Amen. And if you haven't watched it, I encourage you to watch it. But it's a movie about intercessing. Standing in the gap and praying. And you see the young lady there in that room, amen, when she began to pray. Even watching it, it gives you goosebumps. Amen. You can say, well, she's acting. But I don't know when you're praying. I don't know about acting about that. Hallelujah. Because there was some power behind that. And you can feel it, amen, because there's anointing behind whatever you speak unto the Lord, God catches it. Hallelujah. And brings what? Power behind it. Because like somebody said today, amen. Well, somebody sings that it says, no prayer, no power. Much prayer, lots of power. And something about human being, we always want to have power. We strive for power. We go to the gym. You know you can't lift 300, but you're trying to lift 300 because you want power. And then you walk out of there with what? With a back problem. Right? Not knowing you're already lifting 300. or you get it tomorrow. Hallelujah. That was for some of us. Hallelujah. With no problem. Oh, you don't see it. Amen. Right? We're always looking for power. And therefore, you know, the power that we need is found in prayer. Matter of fact, amen, it's one of the most effective weapon that we have in our arsenal. If you look in the Bible, God gives you the armor, right? You read it, the armor of God, the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, the shield of faith, and the shoes of the gospel, the swords of the spirit, amen, the belt of shoe, and we can break it down in Hebrew, Greek, Latin, Spanish, slang, and all that. Right? But on the little scripture in the bottom, it says, and pray. So he gives you all the defensive armor, amen, to defend yourself, but then he gives you an offensive, amen, because we need to fight back. Amen. Right? Today, we're going to watch one of the greatest things that, you know, it was created, the Super Bowl, right? Two teams, amen, which I, you know, we're not there. Sorry. Amen. We were not there. We're going to be watching. But there's going to be two teams fighting. As people say, what? Offense wins games, but defense wants what? Right? Right? So you have to have both things. You have to have offense and a defense. And in Christianity, you have to have defense and an offense. Right? We have all the breastplate of righteousness and the tools to guard us, amen, and the shield of faith to protect us. But also, we have to go and attack. We can never live always on the defensive. Right? We can't be all the time, the devil's attacking me. Which one? I don't know which one I'm carrying it. Amen. Hallelujah. But he's always attacking me. You always got to have a counter attack. And how are you going to have a counter attack if we're not praying? Can I get an amen? Why? Because our weapon that we use will reach any place, anywhere, anytime, and the right target if you are specific. Can I get an amen? If you're hiding from somebody out there in China, amen, I can hit you wherever you're at. Right? Some people thought that, you know, the Americans came with the smart weapons. You know, the smart weapons, you just dial it up and just skip everybody and hit the target. It already was created. It was called prayer. That's what you're here this morning. Because you were doing your thing in your own place in the alley. Hello, somebody. Or that hotel, motel, hiding from family, friends, and stuff. But there was somebody that was praying for you and knew exactly where you were at. Hallelujah. And in the midst of your sin, in the midst of your chaos, the prayer came and hit, boom, right on target, right on the heart. And you felt some kind of thing within your life that you needed to change. Oh, you don't hear me this morning. You hear me, Facebook Live? Amen. You needed some kind of change. You had to do something because you were targeted. And something about being targeted. Not going to Target, but being targeted. People don't feel, they don't feel bad. They feel bad. They feel uncomfortable if you're targeted. Right? Even if people are talking about you or insulting you, you feel targeted and you don't feel good. Why am I getting targeted all the time? Well, you haven't got targeted by prayer yet. When did you get targeted? By prayer. And your whole life goes upside down. You don't even know why. Man, somebody's praying for me. Jeez. Everything's going wrong. Because God wants to get rid of all that stuff so everything can be right. Are you with me this morning? Let me ask you this question this morning. Have you found a place of prayer in your life? Do you have a place called a secret place where you go find yourself and you're going to meet God? Have you found a place that you can separate and say, I'm going to separate and find a place where it's going to be just me and God? That's why I love what we are doing in March 25th. I can't wait. I've been waiting to do this for a long time. We found a place, amen, for our igniting prayer, amen. And I'm challenging people to go, right? And you don't have to go, but I know if you need prayer, you should be the first one signed up. Because guess what we're doing there? Praying. No counseling. Pastor, you got 5 minutes? I need to talk to you. You're going to get hurt because I need prayer. So we need people that are going to go there for prayer, because I'm going to get a hold of God. And we're going to be fasting from that Thursday all the way down to Friday. And there's no escaping. There's not going to the store, sneaking a snack. We're going to know if you left. Hallelujah. Amen. And the only thing moving your mouth is your tongue, because you're praising God, not because you're chewing something. And we're going to be looking at the river and looking at the fireplace, and we're going to get in a hold of God in our secret place. And I believe I'm going to challenge the church to pray until 3 in the morning, because something happens at 3 o'clock in the morning. Read it in the Bible. God always opens the gates of heaven at 3 in the morning. Amen. And the thing is that we're always sleeping, so therefore we miss out sometimes. Unless you get woke up at 3 in the morning. Try it out. Amen. So therefore, amen, we're going to pray until 3 in the morning. And to God begins to speak. I want God to speak. So we're separating. So get your calendars together. $80, it's not even that much for what God is going to do for the rest of your life. Yes. Amen. So let me ask you this question again. Have you found a place that you can call a place of prayer, where you could just find yourself in a place and just be undistracted? Right? Do you have a war room? A private place where you could go daily and intercede, not only for yourself, but for others. Bible talks about, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 6, it talks about, it says, but when you pray, go into a private room. Shut your door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. So therefore, it's scriptural. Amen. A place that you could just find and begin to pray unto the Lord. But let me ask you this question this morning as well. How, if I ask you this morning a survey, how will you rate your spiritual or your prayer life? From 1 to 10. Would you say that from 1 to 10, 1 being cold, 5 being lukewarm, 10 being hot? Where will you rate your prayer life, right? And one of the scenes in the movie, the old lady's talking to the real estate agent, and she asked him, you know, so you're a believer, you're a prayer, you believe in the Lord, right? Correct? And he goes, yeah, but you know, I'm one of those Christians that I'm pretty busy doing stuff, so therefore I fit in God here and there whenever I can and stuff. What would you call your Christian? Say you're hot, cold, or lukewarm. I want to just say lukewarm, kind of a little bit and stuff, but you know, but I believe in God. And she was serving coffee, right? And then she gave him the coffee, and she got her coffee. And then the lady that was saying, I'm serving God lukewarm, the coffee was lukewarm, right? And she was like, so-and-so, like, you like your coffee lukewarm? Because mine is real cold. And then she looked at her and goes, hello? Right? Nobody likes nothing lukewarm or cold. Hallelujah. See, God wants you to be on fire for prayer. And that's what we're trying to just ignite within your life, a prayer life. The first thing I want to talk to you this morning is, first thing is to engage in practice. Engage in the practice of prayer as your most effective weapon. Right? Right there. You got to engage. Notice you got to get involved. Don't wait for crisis to get you involved. Don't wait for something bad to happen in your life so you can get involved. I don't know what was happening with Jeremiah on that time, because it doesn't say, but I know if you read the scripture, he said that he was confined in the courtyard. For those that have been locked up before, you know what confinement is. And also, you know what courtyard is. I don't have to break it down and translate it for you, right? In other words, he was locked up in jail. when he heard the word of God speak to him. In other words, he was in confinement. He was locked up. Something about being locked up, that God always shows up to those that are in prison. Right? If you ever been locked up before, you see the Jesus guys. They get a rude awakening. And they always make vows. Like, if you get me out of this one, God, I will serve you. I will change. Right? You ever heard that before? I'm one of them. Right? I'm that guy. But I don't know what was going on with Jeremiah, but I know a little bit of what was taking place. He found himself in confinement because one of the reasons that he was locked up is because he was preaching the word of God. And in those times, amen, he was a prophet of God. In those times, those there were bold enough to preach the gospel and confess Jesus Christ, because you had to be bold. You couldn't be timid and meek. Amen. You had to be bold and be a prophet and be able to speak and recognize, amen, you will get a penalty, which was being locked up in confinement. But nowadays, confinement and locked up from those days, it does not compare. The jails today can be cushy compared to the jails back in the days. Back in the days, they didn't have water like they had water in the facilities. Back in the days, they didn't have toilets like they had toilets in the days today. Can I get an amen? Matter of fact, they only had a hole in the ground with mud. And your spot was right there in that mud. And then if you're a Christian, you go to third tier, the last one, the worst one, where you can smell everything. And you can't complain about inhumane. Where's my rights? I don't get three meals in a cot. I'm going to sue you. You didn't get that, amen. As a matter of fact, you had no voice. Especially if you had a voice for Christ. So God had to show up. And he showed up in a vision, and he'll show up and speak to Jeremiah. And the word that he will speak to him, it was in verse 3 that says, call to me. Something about prayer that God wants you to speak to him. I don't know how much I got to speak it and preach it and talk about it until we catch it. Right? That God just wants you to talk. God wants you to call out to him and speak to him. Amen. And engage in the practice of prayer, because it's the most effective weapon that you have. Speaking and getting counseling from the pastor, or going to AA or 12 step or 14 step or 21 steps, or reading all kind of books or whatever it is you want to do out there, is not the answer, my friend. It might help you a little bit or for a season. Can I get an amen? But I know this for a fact. If you don't cry out to God, amen, you're going to be stuck where you're at. But if you do cry to God, then my God will hear your cry, and he will show up like a lightning and restore your life. And then you can sing that song, Hell Lost a Soul, I am free, right? You got that one? Hell lost another one. I am free. Right? But for whatever reason, we're made, amen, to question stuff. Right? We always want to question stuff and go our own route and trying to figure out things our own way, when other people just made the path for you so that way you can follow. Right? It happens in church today. You tell them, go this way. No, I'm going to go this way. And then why you came and talked to me for an hour? You know what I could have done for an hour? I could have just been home resting or something. Spend my whole hour and you tell me, oh, you know what? I got it. I'm going to do it this way. Okay, then what the heck? You just waste my time. Right? They got the answer. And then what happens? They keep on repeating the same thing over and over. Then you find you're like 65 years old and you're still doing the same thing, trying to figure out some other route. Hallelujah. That's what's good for us to what? Listen, hear, and engage. Right? Ignite your prayer life. Because without the prayer, that's what we learn in the home. They pray and they pray. We pray when we left the home to go to a job site, fundraiser, right? And we came back and we pray as soon as we got there. We pray, amen, for dinner. We pray, amen. And then we had a specific room that they could go pray, hallelujah. And it was called the prayer closet, amen. Still called the prayer closet. And there in that closet, I left a lot of tears and blood. Because the director couldn't show me because that was the answer. And the answer was, go pray, brother. We wanted this great answer with some wisdom behind it. It used to happen with my dad all the time. I think I shared before, but I was struggling with my Christian life at the beginning. And I wanted to talk to my dad. My dad's a pastor. He used to be a veteran pastor for a long time. He had a lot of wisdom, all kind of wisdom and stuff. So I come with this all kind of criticism that I had or crisis that I had. And I come to him with this stuff. And he says, I hear all this stuff like that, but have you prayed? And I said, no, but I just want to talk to you. Give me some advice. Pray. So I'll go all mad to my room. That's what he told me. Pray. I could have said that myself. I wanted this profile on. Okay, let's break it down. And then I'll get out and I won't pray. And therefore, I will sit there in the living room again, all mad and stuff. And he's like, did you pray? Like a lot of us do. Right? And eventually he said, well, I'm going to try this thing. I'm going to pray. So that way I can sit up and tell him, yeah, I pray. Nothing happened. Right? So I pray, and I start praying, and then something did happen. A breakthrough happened. I got broken. I got baptized in the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I walked out the room. I looked at him and said, I don't need you. I got Jesus now. Hallelujah. And he goes, at least you caught it now. Hallelujah. Come on now. Right? Engage. Say engage. Engage. That's your number one weapon, amen, that we have in our lives. Amen. So where do you practice prayer at? Where? Where is your war room? Where's your place of dedication? Where do you dedicate yourself? Somebody said, this famous preacher by the name of Jim Cimbala, he was a preacher from Brooklyn Tabernacle Church. He said that Satan's main strategic against God or against God's people, that he loves to whisper in Christians' ear, don't call, don't ask, don't depend on God. You're doing great things. It's all fine. It's all good. Don't waste your energy. Isn't it crazy? Because that's when we go through things and stuff, we always want to refer to something else instead of referring to God. And that's what the enemy whispers. So don't go that way. Don't go this way. You're doing fine. You're doing good. Right? When God says, call to me. Call to me is a calling. That you are engaged with God. And that's where Jeremiah and God was telling Jeremiah to call to me. Did he knew that? Did he know that? Yes, he did. But sometimes God has to what? Remind us. So this morning I want you to just find a place of prayer. I have one already. You say, oh, I have one. But make sure that it is not dusty. Make sure that you put in some dent on that pillow if you're kneeling on that pillow, amen, or on that carpet or on your knees, amen, that you got some scars in your knees, hallelujah, and make sure that you're free from distraction. One of the main distractions nowadays is the phone. For whatever reason, when you find your time to go pray, for whatever reason, anybody wants to text you at that time. Is that it just me? Amen. Everybody wants to talk to you. And if you don't answer those texts, oh, Jesus Christ and the Virgin Mary. Pastor's ignoring me. I know you see it. Please respond. I'm like, geez, I'm praying, bro. My bad. Didn't know. Okay. Now you know. Stop texting. Can I get an amen? Right? Or you want me to be in the flesh and just answer all your questions in the flesh? I want to get in the spirit. That's what I love when people go through stuff. I really love to see them pray because God does most, 100% of the job. Right? People come to church and they go through, can I talk to you? No. Talk to me after church. Because I know that God is going to speak to you. So when you're done, afterward, you're like, oh, I got it. Thank you, Pastor. See you later. Like, thank you. Hallelujah. Because I was going to tell you the same thing. Right? The second thing is, the second thing I want to talk to you about, experience the promise of prayer as our most effective weapon. What is God's promise to you when you practice prayer? What is the promise that God has to you, or for us, when you practice your prayer? Now, here in Jeremiah chapter 3, he says, call to me, and the promise that he gave him, I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things. That's his promise. If you call out to God, God says, I'm going to answer you. I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to respond to you. And I'm going to give you great and unsearchable things. Now, unsearchable things, great, we understand what great is, right? We say great things. What is great? Great is something awesome, something great, something big, right? It says, I'm going to give you some great things and unsearchable thing. Unsearchable thing is something that you never imagined that was going to come your way. That you can't even search it because it's not there. It's only going to come through God. It's not like searching a key because you lost your keys, right? You're still searching and looking. You should have the same determination as you're looking for a key to pray. How many lost your keys before? I know that happens in my house all the time. Jeez, the same person all the time. Right? But when you lose your keys, and man, you're searching for it, you're about to break the whole couches. Break somebody's back or something. Man. You had the keys last. Thank God for cameras nowadays. I had cameras at my house too. I got blessed with a plethora of cameras now. I got cameras everywhere here. Amen. But I also got cameras at home. So when they lose the remote, where's the remote? I don't know. I didn't have it last. Who's that guy right there? It looks like you, huh? You did have it last. First of all, you're lying. Second of all, it's right there on the couch right here. Let's pull it out. Hallelujah. Amen. So now they're learning. They're saying, hold on. Let's look at the camera first before I confess for nothing. Hallelujah. You're getting smarter. Amen. So therefore, amen, what is the promises that God gives us? The promise that God gives us, if you pray, then God is going to answer your prayer. But the thing is that God is going to answer a yes, a no, or maybe. Or not yet. But we love the yes. I just wish we could get the yes, the same attitude of the yes with the no's. Because the no's will come. And we don't like it. And we'll call it what? Not of God. Because we don't get it. We didn't get it from God. And we didn't get the answer that we wanted. So therefore, it's not of God. Let me go to the other church. Maybe there's a different God over there. With a different answer. And then you find out you go over there, and he tells you the same answer, which is no. And therefore, it's like, oh, that was not wrong. So let me go back over here. Hallelujah. Because I'm still looking for the right answer, which is still no. Right? And the first people that I see, many other people, but an example I can use real quick about God saying no to somebody was his own son. Jesus Christ, when he went out to the mountain, he left his disciple. He prayed, amen. He was seeking God. He was crying. He was broken. The Bible says that he was sweating even blood, and he was praying that God will remove this cup from me, right? Because he was going to be what? Crucified, and he was going to die on the cross, and he would cry, and he was, please God, remove this cup from me, but if not your will, my will, but let your will be done. And God said, nope. You have to go. Another prime example that when God says no, you have to what? Be obedient to his will. He knows best. Are you with me this morning? So what are the promises that God holds on to your life or that you have that God is going to bless you? I know that when I pray, prayer of a righteous, amen, God will answer. God will see us through. There's some prayers that are answered in our church, and there's testimonies out there that we can hear, amen. A fresh one is Sister Lupe. She's probably watching right now. Amen. That's a fresh testimony. She's been praying to have a child, and she was barren, and she couldn't have no kids. Amen. And she was praying. Eventually, amen, she got pregnant, and a couple of days ago, she gave birth to a beautiful baby girl. Hallelujah. And if you don't know about impossibilities yet, there it is. It's a miracle. It could happen. Right? Some prayers are going to be yes. Some prayers are going to be no. Some prayers are going to be not yet, not ready. Some prayers are going to just wait. Right? The last thing is expect. Expect the power of prayer as the most effective weapon. There's got to be an expectation when you pray. It says, call to me and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says about the houses of the city of the royal palace in Judea and have been torn down to be used against the siege ramp and the sword. Amen. So when you see and continue to read the scripture, you're going to see, amen, the promises of God being fulfilled in Jeremiah's life. In other words, when he found himself in confinement, he was in prison, amen, because the Babylon took over. God allowed those things to take place because of sin that was taking place in that time. Amen. And sometimes the answers of your prayer, you got to have an expectation with an understanding. And sometimes when we come with Christianity, we have an expectation, but when the answer comes your way, we have no understanding. We don't understand it. Why? Because it's divine. Therefore, we need to be prayed up, plugged in, so therefore we can have an understanding. Understand that the purpose of prayer is not to tell God what to do. Have to understand that the purpose of prayer is not to tell God, this is what I want, God, and I want it now in your name. It's not to demand God what you need, what you want, actually. That's not the purpose of prayer. That's not the purpose of prayer. Although we pray sometimes like that. I'll be a better Christian if you give me this, God. How do you know that you will be better? God knows what you need, so therefore you get what you get because God knows exactly what we need.
That's right.
Hello? Right? I didn't get to be an evangelist. That's what I wanted to be. I pray to be an evangelist. Lord, send me. I want to be a worldwide evangelist, Lord. I want to just blow in, blow out. Hallelujah. Cast out in the name of Jesus. Ah, and bounce the next day. Hallelujah. And you'll never see me again till next year. Leave the pastor with all the questions. Hallelujah. That was my once. Man, I could praise the Lord. And I will preach like an evangelist. You know, I still preach like an evangelist. But I'm kind of like a teacher now. But I've been becoming more of a pastor. Amen, hallelujah. But I will preach and I want to be an evangelist just like my uncles and then just travel the world. And man, that sounds beautiful, Lord. I'll be doing your work and I just made it beautiful. And then acceptable to you, Lord. Look at it. I surrender my life. What about a mission? I wanted to be a missionary too, and I prayed to be a missionary. And then there was a time, a season, amen, and Mighty Men of Valor, they were recruiting people to go to Australia, right? And they were saying, we need some people, some soldiers to rise up. We're going to go to Australia. We're going to invite. And I said, yes, I'll go to Australia. I don't know what time, but I'll go.
Here we go. Let's go to Australia. Yes. I even went with an attitude of I was happy as 10 clowns, as they say. Hallelujah. And I went to Pastor. I know my calling, Pastor. I want to go to Australia. Amen. And be part of the team over there. And he looked at me. He goes, nope. I go, what? He said, you're going to go to the home and run the home. That's your missionary work. Hallelujah. And I go, amen. Hello. And I ran the home for 5 years. And thank God that I ran it for 5 years, because he was preparing me for what? For now. You're never going to get what you want. Sometimes it's what you need. Right? See, the purpose of prayer is to build, amen, or to allow God to build a relationship with you and I. Right? As I get the keyboard and the worship team this morning, let me ask you the question about what are great things in life. What are great things? What are your great things that you think are great for you? Have you ever thought about that before? Have you ever had that question of what are great things in my life? Because we say it all the time in church. God has something great for you. He goes, yeah, I know. Do you know what great is? Because sometimes we have the wrong definition of what great is in our lives. Sometimes we have the wrong definition of what great is in our lives. We always think that great things are this, behind the pulpit and preaching in front of thousands, and souls are getting here and saved, and slain in the spirit and changing and stuff, and you're praying, and you're like Benny Hill, and everybody's just falling on the floor, and that's you, and everybody, oh, look at him. Things, that's probably one of the great things, but great thing can be the smallest things in your walk. Even vacuuming the church, that's great. That's a great thing, preparing the church for the souls that are coming in. That's a great thing. Everybody starts from the bottom. And that's you call bottom? That's not even bottom, because God says, even Jesus says, I came not to be served, but to serve. So if you're a servant, then you're doing great things. That's what I'm saying this morning. If you're a servant, you're a willing servant, your mouth is shut, amen, hallelujah, and you are a servant, and you serve, amen, to the kingdom of God, then you're doing great things. It's not about the prestige, the lights, cameras. We can say that now. The smokes. We don't have smokes. But probably next week we'll have smokes. It's not about that. Because usually those that are here are here. Not usually. But yeah, usually. 100%. That are here right now, they become a target. Not a small target. Not a wearing a t-shirt, I'm from Target. Not that target. A big target. Front and back. Correct? Oh, everybody loves to be up here. They get upset too if they're not up here. But you guys are watching and the cameras are watching. But guess who else is watching? God is watching, but guess who else is watching? And he will love. I want to make this dramatic because I'm Puerto Rican. He would love to grab James by the hair. Let me show you what's up, buddy. He would love to do that. Drag our name to the dirt. And if you're not prayed up, that's domestic violence. Don't do that. Amen. But I'm just being dramatic. But that's what God does. That's what the devil does. He will love. And if you're not prayed up, if you're not in a closet, if you're faking the funk, if you're hiding it and looking good, he'll go straight to it. I can smell you, buddy. I don't know, you see, brother. My buddy. Stop poking him. And everything becomes irritated. You don't want this guy mad. You don't get mad that much, but when he does. I know him for a long time. Hallelujah. And that's what the devil does. He targets those that he knows that are not plugged into their prayer life. Especially the leaders. Especially those that want this. Especially those that are doing vacuuming. You see people mad because they got a vacuum? Man, I got to vacuum this place. I don't even do it in my house. That's when you ain't married. That's when you're single. That's when you're still living with your mom. Woo, that's a lot of them. You better have your shields. Ding, ding, ding. Like Wonder Woman, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Learn how to serve. Learn how to get a hold of God. Become a warrior. A prayer warrior is on your knees. You don't have to proclaim it, because whatever you do in secret, God is going to reward you in heaven. Can I get an amen? You don't have to say, I pray for an hour in my closet, brother. Feel me. You feel the anointing? You feel the power? Don't you feel it? You don't have to do that. God is going to exalt you. God is going to uplift you. Something about coming to the steps here, amen, that is something powerful that separates you from here to there. Hallelujah. That when you walk in here, if you're not prayed up, it's going to show up. You're going to feel the anointing flowing, and you're not going to feel the anointing flowing. Usually they'll get attacked before church service, after church service, or even during church service. Sometimes my wife got to tell people to smile. Smile, sister, or you gonna... You look like you're mad. I'm going through it. Right? That's what's important. Warriors. We're looking for prayer warriors. We should have a prayer warrior day. Everybody talks about it, but one day they'll say, one day we'll do it. We should have some people that are praying, interceding, intercessors in the house of God. And that's what I'm trying to ignite. I walk around with a lighter. Although I don't smoke. But I walk around with a lighter, trying to ignite. Come on, bro, get on fire. I'm going to burn you. Can you get some gas? This guy right here is damn, hallelujah. I want to lit him up. Amen. Because I want to lit up. I want to lit up the fire. Come on. I want to lit up the fire. So that would think, I only don't have one prayer warrior. I have two. And then I have three. And then I have four prayer warriors. I have five. I have 10. I have 20. I have 30 prayer warriors. Imagine if you have the whole church as a prayer. The devil won't even dare come into the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. He won't even think about it. I ain't going in there. I'm going next door. Oh, you didn't hear that one. I'm going over there. It starts with the victory. But this one right here, amen. I don't know. They have a little step. Hallelujah. They have a step on their walk. Amen. They had a purpose. They jump on fire. Hallelujah. They got revival going on. They're prayed up. Hallelujah. The hands of God is moving. Miracles are taking place. People are getting healed. Hallelujah. Oh, you don't hear me this morning. We want to just light you up. Or pump you up so you can go to the next step. I don't know about you, but I get sick and tired of enemy attacking me. I don't enjoy it. Do you guys enjoy that? I don't. That's why I just bend my knees and I fight back. In the street, that's what we used to do, right? Unless, I don't know, not 2021, I don't know how they go now. But back in the day, somebody hits you, you hit back. Right? It's called what? Payback. You know, not the candy payback or payday. But anyways, this morning, some of us need to go pray and pay back what the enemy stole from your life. Right? You have to be united. Some of you guys, the enemy stole your family or trying to steal your marriage or still trying to take away your kids and your children, your finance, your job. And we are just what? Oh, the devil's attacking me, Pastor. You know, no, I don't know. You know what I mean? No, I do not know what you mean. The devil attacks me too. But he hates it when I shout Jesus. He hates it when I lift my hands and worship God. He hates it when I praise him. That's what we like to shout and scream. That's what you see Albert running around. Come on, get excited. He hates that. You know, some of you got hated too. Man, what's the guy crazy running around? Right? See, the devil hates it too. Be quiet, bro. He's like tempering sneers in his ear. Right? But no, we want to be timid Christians. We can't be timid Christians. If there's any time in the world for prayer warriors, it's now. We need some prayer warriors in the house of God. Come on. You're there standing, stand on Facebook Live. We're going to sing a worship song. Amen. And I'm going to open this altar here this morning. If that's you this morning, amen, you want to be a prayer warrior. You need your prayer to be ignited. Amen. Come to this altar this morning. Lift your hands and surrender. Cry out to God. Shout to God.
Here I am, ready and willing. Here I am. Use me today and let your anointing fall upon me. Fill me with your spirit, oh Lord, I pray. Here I am, ready and willing. Here I am. Use me today and let your
Hallelujah. Just get in tune. Get involved. Come on, get involved in your prayer right now. Hallelujah. Come on, cry out to God. Ignite the fire. Ignite my prayer life, God. Oh, ignite it, Father God. Ignite my prayer, God. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Prayer. Call to me and I will answer. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, shatarababa, kasiarababa. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Right there on Facebook Live, right there where you're at. Those that are here this morning, come on. Pray with me this morning. Pray with me this morning. Come on, let's pray for those that are lost this morning. Let's come together in unity. For those that are lost in church as well, for those that are lost out there in the world, let's stand in the gap for the souls that are lost right now. Together right now. Let's stand in a gap for your family member right now. Call to me and I will answer. Come on, stand in a gap for your family member right now. Call them by name. Call them by name in the name of Jesus, I pray. Oh, hallelujah. Come on. Oh, hallelujah for their salvation, Lord. Come on, pray for the backslider. Oh, I pray for the backslider, Lord. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we pray for the souls that are hurting in Tri-City and throughout the inland Northwest. Oh, we send your Holy Spirit, Father God, that disturbs their miserable life, Father God, in the name of Jesus right now. Touch them right now, Father God. Target that individual right now that tried you out of darkness. Reach them in that hotel, motel. Oh, that house, Father God. That alley right now. Oh, in every city, Father God. In that Northwest, Father God. Yeah, come on. Sunnyside, Prosper, Grandview. Oh, hallelujah. Othello, Hermiston, hallelujah. Richland, Galloway, Pasco. Burbank, Finley, Lord, hallelujah. Moses Lake, Spokane, Father God. Idaho, Boise, Idaho. Oh, hallelujah. Send your Holy Spirit, Father God, like a wave, hallelujah, of salvation, Father God. Break the yoke of bondage. Set the captives free, hallelujah. Bring them to this church, hallelujah. 421 South Vancouver, Victory Irish Tri-City, God. Oh, hallelujah. Bring them to that victory home, God. Bring them to that victory home for the men and for the women, Father God. Prepare the way, Father God. Reach their families, Father God. Reach their loved ones. Bring them to the feet of knowledge, to your knowledge, Father God. Oh, hallelujah. Raise up some warriors, hallelujah. Raise up some prayer warriors, Father God. Raise up some prayer warriors, God. Raise up some prayer warriors, God. Raise up an army, God. Raise up a prayer warrior, intercessors, Father God. Raise up some intercessors, hallelujah. Oh, that loves to pray for unto you, God. Oh, rest of the pack. Give them passion. Give them passion for prayer, God. Give them passion for prayer, God. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, we pray right now, Father God. Seal this message. Stir their hearts, Father God. Challenge the people this morning, Father God, to get that prayer room. The war, Father God, is on the floor, God. Not against each other, but it's on the floor, Father God, praying for each other. Only you can change people's life. Only you can change people's mind. Only you can heal the sick and the impossible, God. Bring them to your feet. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray right now. Amen. And amen. Come on, let's give it up for Jesus this morning. Who's in the house this morning? Tampa Bay. Come on now. We got a one fan. Hallelujah from the Tampa Bay. Hallelujah. God bless you. We'll see you next week.